7. And but I wanted to talk just a little bit about the love that the ministry has for the church. The love that the ministry has for the church. I'm going to be reading this because this is the love that the Apostle Paul was showing to the church there at Colossians. So, Lord, we thank you for this day, O God. We ask for your spirit to move. We ask for your spirit to touch, O God, in Jesus' name. In verse number 9 of Colossians chapter 1, it says, "For this cause, we also, since the day that we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will." Say, the knowledge of his will. Praise God. "In all wisdom and spiritual understanding." Number 10 says, "And ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God." In verse number 11, it says, "Strengthening with all might according to his glorious power unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness." Praise God. You may be seated. The love that the ministry has for the church. To pray for the church. Not just for healings. Not just for financial blessings, which that's one thing that we do. And we do pray for those things. And God does answer those prayers. But for the church to know the will of God. For the church to understand, even though the Apostle Paul was a long ways away, he decided that the church needed his presence. And the only way that he could be there in the church with them is to pray for them. And so he rejoiced in hearing about their faith. He rejoiced in hearing about the love. He rejoiced in hearing about the hope. But what really brought joy to his heart was knowing that they were in the will of God. Knowing that you're in the will of God brings pleasure to the ministry. Because when we pray, we want to know that you're in the will of God and God is really moving. It's easy to say, we'll pray for this or we'll pray for that. And sometimes, you know, we have even corporate prayer here. We'll have it at the end of the month on Saturday. Those prayer meetings are so phenomenal. They are something that you don't want to miss. If you've never been to a corporate prayer on Saturday, come this Saturday at 10 o'clock, because the power of God is in this place. And the will of God. Hallelujah. I guess maybe that's probably the number one question that I've been asked over the time that I've been a minister. When someone has talked to me, they have said, you know, if I just knew what the will of God was for my life. And that seems to be something that people struggle with. You notice that Paul didn't pray for them that was persecuted. He didn't pray for them to prosper. He didn't pray for them to gain financial wealth. But he said that they would be in the will of God. Hallelujah. He desired for them to be filled with the knowledge of his will. He desired for them to be, and it was important for Paul to pray for them. It was part of what he does is pray. You know, we have had here, and it's probably been, Brother Carnes, it's been, 3 years that we've been doing early morning prayer at 6 o'clock, Tuesday and Thursday. The lights are on. The doors are open. Anybody can walk in. Anybody can come in. 6 o'clock on Tuesdays and Thursdays. If you really want to know what the will of God is for your life, show up. God will be here. I guarantee you, he'll be here. He'll be here. The Apostle Paul wanted them to also, he prayed for that they would, their walk would be mighty, that their walk would be worthy of the Lord. That's a powerful thing. We have to know what God wants in our life. We have to understand what God wants to do in our life. We want to gain spiritual understanding. If we want to gain spiritual understanding, we can do that through prayer. If we want to gain spiritual understanding, we can do that through Bible study. If we want to gain spiritual understanding, we can do that through worship. Because through our worship, we can understand some of the spiritual things that God wants us to understand. Being in the will of God, walking worthy of the Lord. What a powerful, powerful verse of Scripture. It is to walk in the Spirit. I'm going to read this one verse real quick. It says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." Ephesians 5 and 2 says, "And walk in love, all as Christ also has loved us and has given himself for an offering and a sacrifice of God for a sweet-smelling savor." It is to walk as the children of light, according to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 8. "For if we are sometimes in darkness, but now we are in the light of the Lord." Walking as children of light. We might have been in darkness one time, but no more. We're in the light now. We understand. We can see God is moving. God is moving. Hallelujah. We're not children of the dark. We're children of the light. Hallelujah, hallelujah. When we walk worthy of the Lord, others notice. You're not just walking worthy of the Lord for yourself, but everybody that is around you is noticing your walk with God. Is that important? Yes. Knowing God well enough to talk to him like a friend. People know when you know God. They come to you asking you, "Hey, can you get a hold of your friend for me?" How do you pray for those that you love, for those that you work with, for your neighbors? How do you pray for them? You know, prayer centered around prosperity doesn't normally work. Preaching centered around prosperity doesn't work. We have preachers that are all over this country. They have huge congregations. And you hear about problems and testimonies. People are not happy. Prosperity doesn't make them happy. Temporary things don't make them happy. You can have a brand new car. You can have a brand new house. You can have the best job. And you can be on a hotline with depression or a suicide hotline. It does not make you happy. But praying gives us that ability to know what God's will is for our life. Praying allows us to reach out and grab a hold of something that will grab us back. Hallelujah. Walking with God, how important is that? God loves each and every one of you. And the ministry in this church is praying that God will bless you with letting you know what his will is for your life. God bless you.
Would you mind standing for just a moment as we once again thank you, Brother Goff. Oh, I welcome all of you to the Bartley United Pentecostal Church, Salah. So nice to meet you this morning before church. Let's welcome Salah. Oh, I pray God does something really awesome for you guys today. Raul, good to see you again. He's been here before. Exodus chapter 1 and verse 8. Give you a chance to... wish you wouldn't talk about apple pie before I get up to... I thought they'd at least have one in the welcome in the hospitality room before church. How many are left now? 10, 9, 8. Exodus 1, verse 8. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. And he said unto his people, Behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply. And it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also unto our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land. Therefore, they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with their burdens. And they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew. And they were grieved because the children of Israel and the Egyptians made the children of Israel to serve with rigor, and they made their lives bitter with hard bondage in mortar and in brick and in all manner of service in the field. All their service wherein they made them serve was with rigor. In verse 10 in the Message, it says, Let us deal wisely with them. Form some wise schemes. Take some crafty methods to weaken and diminish them gradually, not with open force of arms, but in a more private and secret manner and less observed. The Pharaoh of Egypt saw the power, the opportunity, the ability that was inside the people of Israel. And he began to get nervous when God blessed them, multiplied them. And he talked to his advisors and said, We need to come up with a plan to try to deceive them and make them think that they are somebody different than they are. I want to talk to you this morning about a subject, a prisoner of war. A prisoner of war. Would you mind praying with me just for a moment? Lord, talk to us about your precious word. Would you bring understanding to us and help us to understand your word in a more meaningful way this morning? And give us knowledge, give us wisdom of your word, and help us to apply it to our lives. Bless this wonderful people, I pray, Lord. And God, let your touch and anointing be upon them. I pray that you would send them out of here today, Lord, stronger, God, aware of the weapons of the enemy, but also, God, let them know what the will of God is for their life. Let them go out of here with power and authority, I pray, in Jesus' name. Everyone said, in Jesus' name. Shake hands with someone and say, I can't wait to hear the message today. General Jonathan Wainwright was the only United States general ever captured by the enemy during World War II. He was left in charge of Corregidor, Philippines, by his superior, Douglas MacArthur, who was then forced to flee to Australia to organize the Allied forces' massive counterpunch that eventually defeated Japan. MacArthur's orders to Wainwright were very clear. Never surrender. Fight to the end. Wainwright tried very hard to stick to the letter of that order. However, the massive, systematic, merciless destruction he saw around him finally forced him, against his own convictions, to finally surrender. He and what was left of his ragtag army were shipped off to prison of war camps all over Asia. Thousands even died while in transit Wainwright himself ended up in a POW camp in Mongolia. The Japanese guarded him as a precious prize. After all, he was the only U.S. general they would ever capture. During those terrible years of captivity, Wainwright labored under tremendous guilt as he saw his body deteriorate and come to depend on a cane to move around. His soul experienced even greater deterioration. He felt like a total failure for having surrendered Corregidor. In due time, Douglas MacArthur led his troops to total victory. The Empire of the Rising Sun became the Empire of the Setting Sun as MacArthur and his troops evicted the Japanese from island after island all over the Pacific. He eventually occupied Japan and took up residence in Tokyo. The once formidable Japanese Empire finally surrendered to the fugitive from Corregidor. When this happened, POW camps were liberated all over Asia. Because Wainwright was held in Mongolia, far away from Tokyo, his camp commandant was able to keep the truth from him for a while. Consequently, Wainwright continued to behave like a POW. Can you picture this Japanese commandant watching Wainwright after Japan's surrender? He knew they would soon switch places, and the commandant must have trembled at the possibility of facing a captive who would eventually become his captor. Every time he saw him, the Japanese commandant must have felt tremendous uneasiness. A fully armed, properly fed commandant with more than adequate military force at his disposal was afraid of the weak, emaciated, dysentery-plagued remains of a ragtag army and its limping general. Why? Because the Japanese commandant's power over them was based on a lie. Can you picture him wondering, has he found out yet? If he has, what will happen to me? The only thing that enabled the Japanese commandant to keep up this fraud was Wainwright's ignorance of the truth. Is truth not important today? Wainwright had been liberated, but he didn't know it. How many people in this room, may I ask, have already been liberated, but they just don't know the truth? Neither was he aware that, like every Allied POW all over Asia, he had been ordered by his commander-in-chief to take charge of the very camp that held him captive. Is God speaking to somebody today about taking charge of the camp that you now sit as a captive? Because he didn't know the truth, he continued to submit to the commands of his captor, even though his captor no longer had power over him. Oh, I know some people today that feel like they're a prisoner of war. Their circumstances have them in prison. Their failures, the baggage that they drag with them through life, has them feeling as if they are merely a prisoner, responding to every whim of their commandant. But something similar to that happened more than 3,000 years ago in Egypt. As I read, Pharaoh had absolute power in his empire and had defeated every foe within thousands of miles. However, still having a fear, with all of that power, with all of that authority that Pharaoh had, the fear that he may eventually lose his slaves, his Israelite slaves, if they ever realized who they actually were. The Israelites were merely shepherds without weapons. Humanly speaking, they were powerless. Pharaoh feared not so much the people, but the truth, which if ever discovered, would empower them. What truth lies beneath the surface today that if you would ever discover the truth about what God wants to do in your life would truly set you free, would really give you an opportunity to become what God is calling you to become? Pharaoh knew that if war ever broke out, and it was in our reading, our text this morning, he knew that if it ever broke out, that he would lose. He had to avoid confrontation at all cost. His fear was not just that he would be killed or invaded, but mostly that he would lose his captives. Pharaoh's power was based on a lie. And no one fears the truth more than a liar. In John 8:32, it says, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Knowing what God's will is for your life, knowing what God wants you to do, knowing the power that God has available for you, knowing the absolute weapons that God wants to place in your hands and wants you to learn how to use, will empower you and will make you free. Not knowing truth is what causes the captivity of all of the Americans today, of all of the people in this world, not knowing what God is wanting to empower you with, causes us to remain captive. It causes us to remain taking commands from somebody who really doesn't have the power. They just have us convinced that they're in charge. But the only person that should be in charge of your and my life is Jesus Christ. He's the one that has the intention to do right by us. His fear, Satan's fear, is that the church will realize that it really is mightier than he is. In 1 John 4, verse 4, it finishes by saying, "Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." There is a power that can be in us that can be far greater than the powers that are out there. Yes, I'm talking about nuclear power. I'm talking about all of the governmental power. I'm talking about the religious power. I'm talking about financial power. There is no power out there that is greater than one of you on your knees talking to the Creator of all heaven and earth. There is no power that can stand against that. Scripture tells us that the church is the body of Christ. And there is no one that knows the power of the body of Christ like Satan. Jesus in his body withstood Satan, cast out thousands of demons, took charge in his body. So Satan knows that the body of Christ has greater power than he does. What are you today? Know ye not that you are the temple of God and that the power of God and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? For by one Spirit are we baptized into one body, whether you be Jew or Gentile or Greek, or it doesn't matter. We are baptized into one body. If you are baptized into the body of Christ, you possess greater power than that of Satan himself. When the church enters war, it literally allies itself with those that hate Satan, and that's the angels of God. When you decide that, you know, whether you're involved in the war or not, there is a war going on. It's already in progress and was in progress for thousands of years. The thing is that when we decide to get involved, you're not just saying, "I want to be a part of Bartlett United Pentecostal Church." You're saying, "I want to partner with the angels of God and God himself in fighting evil, in fighting unrighteousness, in fighting satanic power, in fighting evil governments." We're standing as righteousness in God's place against this world. The core of Satan's fear is that the church will depart from the land of captivity. Satan, his greatest fear is that you will realize who you are and that you will choose to stand and say, "I want to be part of God's army. I am willing to stand against evil." His empire will crumble faster than communism did if we will ever choose to become part of that powerful army. But the church must learn, Brother Goff, to pray with authority, not as a POW begging for crumbs of bread, but as an advancing army that knows it is destined for victory. Do we limp through our day wondering if God will help us make it through the day? Or do we start our day on our knees and get up from that prayer and say, what victory are you going to involve me in today, God? What miracle are you going to let me be a part of? I know what you're going to be doing. You're going to be taking authority over all sorts of territories and devil's area, and I want to be involved. I want to help you, Jesus. I want to be used of you in opening the prison doors of captives and setting the captive free. That's what I want today. The normal state of affairs between the church and Satan is war. That's normal. If you're not in war, then you're not normal. I want to be in war. I want to be involved in fighting God's fight for the sake of souls around this world. All through the Bible, we see examples of Satan's enslaving God's people by hiding the truth from them, saying, I will deal wisely with them, just like Pharaoh did. But we also see deliverance come every time God's people discover the truth and access his power through prayer. It happened in Egypt with Moses. It happened in Babylon with Daniel. It happened in Persia with Nehemiah. It happened in Acts with Peter and Paul. Truth was revealed, and angels were dispatched to bring the answer. Peter being in prison, the people prayed. Angel respond and unlock the doors for Peter. That's what happens when we pray. That's what happens when the church decides to get on its knees and say, we have no answer. We can't cure cancer. We can't take somebody out of prison. We can't stop spiritual onslaught unless we're on our knees. Then we have greater power. And the walls were shaken as they were filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, we can shake this world. We can set the captive free if we'll pray. Pharaoh had a three-point plan. In order to break free from Satan's POW camp, we need to realize how we ended up there in the first place. Pharaoh knew that he did not have power, so he resorted to craftiness. First of all, he deceived them. The Israelites were never really slaves of Pharaoh, but he convinced them that they were. He dealt wisely with them, a delicate way of saying that he cheated them. Think about it. Joseph's generation, they didn't go there as slaves. They became slaves because they were convinced that that's what they were supposed to do. But those that had firsthand information of their real status with Joseph, they died. What is that telling us? We need to make sure that freedom never becomes a secondhand experience. We can't say we're free because Pastor Yance was free. We can't say that we're free because my grandma was free, or my parents were free, or my brother or sister or mother or father was free. Freedom can never be a secondhand experience. It has to be experienced firsthand. I need to know that I'm free. Because it says, he that the Son sets free is free indeed. It doesn't say you're free because of your grandpa's prayer. Hallelujah. Power can never be a secondhand experience. Miracles should never be a secondhand experience. The Holy Ghost should never be a secondhand experience. Truth should never be a secondhand experience. We need to see the truth for ourselves. We should never just go to a church because it says, well, the pastor sure is passionate about what he believes. My goodness, if we don't know the truth, we'll never be free. But if we can see it for ourselves, flesh and bone hath not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven, he is revealing it. Jesus. Pharaoh never wielded a weapon over the people of Israel. He simply hid the truth from them. Ignorance is powerful, but truth is more powerful. Are we unsure which promises are for today, thinking that some of those miracles were merely for the apostles? Why is it that in our own thinking we hold the apostles to some higher pillar or high stand? Have we devised respectable ways to explain our supernatural anemia or moral feebleness? I just can't live for God. Sin just has power over me. Supernatural anemia, that's a lack thereof. We're going to explain it away. We're going to somehow tell people how it just doesn't happen today. Some people and preachers and churches even have a theology of powerlessness designed to explain why God will not do what he had said in his word that he will do. Theology without power. Our prayers seem to be written by lawyers who qualify every sentence to provide God with a way out in case no answer comes. Sometimes I hear prayers and I'm thinking, that didn't sound like faith to me. God, if by chance, if you can find a way out, We always give it a chance to say, well, I guess it's just not time. I guess it's just not the will of God. We pray thinking about excuses to give people for why it didn't happen. The Bible says that if we pray and not doubt in our heart, providing excuses is giving a reason or providing doubt. We've got to pray and say, I thank you for healing my body. I thank you for doing, I thank you, God. I'm not giving you any room to wiggle. God, you promised that whatever I ask in your name, I will do it. That's what you said. Wow. I will. We implement decisions based on risk management principles. Preachers teach about miracles but have never seen one. They learn about revivals but never experience one. They study about prayer, but it seldom radically changes things around us. We hear about a victorious Christ before whom every knee will bow and meanwhile watch the enemy move boldly all over our city, in our community, in our country. We've turned a battlefield we were supposed to occupy victoriously into a massive POW camp. We have become content with surviving rather than overcoming. We have believed the lie that we are not to engage the enemy. We have been deceived. Don't stir him up. I want to stir him up. I'm not a, if the devil could have destroyed, oh, don't talk about him that way. He'll meet you in the parking lot. Let's have at it. I haven't had a good brawl with him lately. If he could have destroyed you, he would have already done it. He wouldn't have let you wake up this morning. He would have covered your face with a pillow and had you doze off into eternity. If he could destroy you, he would have already done it. But he deceives. He makes you think, I'm just supposed to be patient. Remember, if you ask for patience, just let it happen on its own, all right? Tribulation worketh patience. Tribulation is the bridge between what you are now and patience. Let it come as God orders, not God, give me patience and give it to me right now. First thing Pharaoh did was deceive them. The second thing he did was dominate them, because deception always breeds domination. The Egyptians appointed taskmasters to overwhelm the Israelites with abuse, designed to obliterate the possibility of escape in their minds. They were so busy trying to keep their taskmasters happy that they never noticed how powerful they were becoming. The Pharaoh noticed it, but they didn't. They could have easily risen up against the Pharaoh and his armies, but they didn't because they were too busy worrying about today, worrying about tomorrow. Today, Satan heaps all kinds of mischief on the church. Immorality, infighting, divorce, rebellious children, spiritual powerlessness. He wants us to forget that we are to be soldiers, not slaves. He afflicts us with hard labor so that we become bitter, so preoccupied with our own misery that we lose sight of the reason that we're here. We're so busy trying to survive like a POW. I just can't wait for the next cup of broth so that it will get me to tomorrow. That is not a soldier. A soldier says, I can't wait to engage the enemy for the next 1 foot of territory that we're going to overcome. We will overcome. The church will not fail. It's just a matter of, will we be in it when it succeeds? The church is destined for victory, and I will be in the church. I will choose to be a soldier in God's army. I will never fail because I'm never leaving the church. Satan does it by causing us to confuse trials, which come from God, with burdens that Satan imposes on us. Yeah, hold on a minute. With POW mentality, we accept that he has a right to abuse us. God doesn't give us burdens. God gives us trials. Because we believe that God has all power, we think that God approves of this abuse. Well, I must be getting too proud. I must have pride in my life. So if I have pride in my life, God, you go ahead and let the enemy beat me up for a while. I don't think so. God doesn't abuse his children. God is not an abusive parent. We find ourselves thanking God for trials that are really burdens imposed on us by Satan. Trials bring with them the necessary grace to endure, while burdens are meant to destroy. It's crucial that we be able to distinguish one from another. If the devil wants to put a burden on us, we need to know. If God puts a trial on us to test us, to strengthen us, we need to be able to identify the two so that we can accept a trial and refuse a burden. Because on the surface they're somewhat similar, Satan is able to take advantage of us. I'll deceive them into thinking that my burden is a trial from God. They'll go ahead and accept it. It'll slow them down. It'll distract them. It'll keep them so busy they won't ever try to fight me. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul was talking about someone feeling such a burden. He said, lest perhaps such a one should be swallowed up with overmuch sorrow. He said, God never intended us to be swallowed up with so much sorrow. I have such a heavy burden on my heart. I just can't do anything. Sometimes we carry burdens, and God's like, what are you carrying that for? I took that to the cross a long time ago. Why don't you just accept my trials? And that will teach you, that will mold and shape you instead of a burden that will weigh you down and destroy you and crush you. A trial is like undergoing surgery in the best hospital, while a burden is like being stabbed by a mugger in a dark alley. There's some superficial similarities. In both cases, a foreign object cuts our flesh. Bleeding occurs and there's potential for infection. But what's the basic difference between the two? Intention. A surgeon brings strength. A mugger takes advantage. Both of them cut. Both of them need healing. Both of them expose us to infection. But the intention of a surgeon is to help. The intention of a mugger is to take advantage of you. Whew. Wow, you're thinking, that's good. Galatians 6:5 says, for every man, this is a scripture people use, for every man shall bear his own burden. See, Pastor, you're not telling us the truth. I looked it up. It says, shall bear his own burden. Every single commentator that I read said this. It doesn't mean, okay, I just have a burden to carry. It means I will accept the reward of his or her labor. It's like whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. It says, every man shall bear his own burden. It means if I do this, then I need to accept the responsibility for my actions. That's what it means. I will bear my own burden. It doesn't say I'm going to bear the burden of the world. It doesn't say I'm going to bear the burden of my family, bear the burden of my neighbor, bear the burden. It says I will bear my own burden. That means what I have done, that I will be responsible for. When a burden, when they appear, don't welcome them, but resist and reject them. Trying to find value in burdens is like banging your head against a wall to find out how good it feels when you finally stop. Oh, I feel better now. My dad would always tell me, I hurt myself. And I'm like, my finger hurts. He said, well, take a hammer and hit your big toe. I said, why? He said, well, then you won't remember your finger hurts. He didn't mean that on purpose. He was just being funny. But some of us are like that also. God, I'm going to go ahead and carry this thing that I'm not responsible for and just hope that someday it'll stop. When Christians submit to the mindset of a POW, bitterness cannot be far away. We're not supposed to be there. And when we are there, things happen that aren't supposed to happen. And because they do, we become bitter. Because we're convinced that we're supposed to carry this burden because God gave it to us. And God is like, I didn't give you that thing. And then we're mad at God because we're carrying this thing that we're not supposed to carry. Why did this happen to me? It's because we didn't listen to God. We didn't allow God to direct our lives. This kind of situation is so biblically abnormal that anger soon comes, almost immediately. A lot of times, subconsciously, we're angry about something, but we don't really know why. It's because we're carrying a burden that we're not supposed to carry. We became bitter. Bitterness eats up its container, and we become angry because this is not the way a Christian is supposed to live. Aren't I supposed to be blessed, at least have some peace? Yes. Put down the burden. Don't carry it unless God gives you a trial to test us. Israel built cities of storage. Look at this. Israel, not technically labeled a slave, but just overcome by their taskmasters. Hey, you better do this, and if you don't, I'm going to whip you. They didn't go there to be slaves. They went there to be blessed of God. That's why God put them there. But they built cities of storage, treasure cities, for Pharaoh, helping him to strengthen his position. Israel worked to strengthen their enemy's position because they were in a place that they should not have been. We, through things that we do, literally, the quasi-Christian world strengthens the position of the enemy because they remain in a POW position. They don't take a position of authority over the enemy, but they submit to somebody who really doesn't have authority over them. And so in doing so, the things that they're doing are building up treasure cities for the enemy. We come up with man-made theological explanations for what cannot be biblically explained because we're not supposed to be doing it. Some of the most damaging weapons in Satan's arsenal have been developed by Christian slave labor. Doubt. Holy Ghost isn't for today. Speaking in tongues is of the devil. Miracles don't happen today. On and on and on. All these lies that are out there were created by the Christian world. Why? Because it doesn't happen for them. They're a POW-based mentality, and they've caused all of the Christian world to fall after that and to say, we're just going to be patient, and we're going to be full of grace. The gospel has ceased to be good news and has become merely good advice. The gospel was never intended to be good advice. It's The gospel was designed to liberate, to provide freedom, to provide power, to provide miracles, signs, and wonders, to provide salvation. Overcoming has been replaced by coping. We're happy to simply survive rather than escape. So the second thing the devil does, like Pharaoh, is to dominate. The last thing, he began to destroy them. In Exodus 1, Pharaoh ordered all the Israelite baby boys to be destroyed. You look at that and you think, well, we know that baby boys grow up to be bigger boys who end up becoming soldiers, and that's why he did it. But the genius of the scheme was not just that he killed the future battlers, the future soldiers of Israel, but a scheme was that it combined death with life and abuse with false mercy. What I'm saying is, instead of just saying, I'm going to kill the boys, I'm going to allow the baby girls to live. I'm going to give you something. Think about it. If somebody came here and said, we're going to kill all of the children in the world, well, people would rise up, but he only killed half or tried. We're going to allow you to keep some. Satan does that. He does that to you and he does it to me. He says, you know what? I'm going to take this away, but I'm going to let you keep a little bit. Because if I give you something, then you'll at least feel like you have something to hold on to. But if Satan walked in and took everything away, you'd rise up. It's like if our government came in and stripped us of all of our authority, of all, we would rise up and say, no. But what do they do? Every vote is just a little step further. Let's just take this away and take this away and take this away. And next thing you know, we're like, where did we start? How did we get here? That's what the government does. That's what Satan does. One little piece at a time. And you look and you say, yeah, but at least I have this left. God never intended for you to have this left. God intended for you to have all of the authority that he wanted you to have. Oh God, Pharaoh appeared gracious by letting him keep their daughters like a POW commandant who allows starving prisoners to celebrate Christmas with care packages sent from home. We're going to keep you imprisoned. We're going to keep you weak, but we'll give you a little gift now and then. That's how we respond. God, if you'll just give us a miracle every month. If you'll just let me hear about it, God. Just give me a little, it's like golf. In the pond, in the sand, every once in a while, boop, on the green. You keep going. You just keep going. And you think, I'm never going to play this game again. And boom, boom, forget it. Boop. Every once in a while, you get just a little gimme. Just a little something to keep you going. You know what I'm saying? That's what the devil does. He wants you to think that as long as we hear about a miracle, as long as somebody receives the Holy Ghost in this world, as long as somebody's having revival, you know, you got to be happy for somebody else. You know what? I am happy for somebody else, but I want it to happen here. I want everybody to receive a miracle that wants one. I want God, because God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that worketh in us. I'm glad for them, but I'm sad for us when we don't have miracles. Pharaoh's ultimate objective was to destroy their fruitfulness. Satan's strategy has been to remove every reference to spiritual warfare from our vocabulary. Don't fight, just survive. Do we emphasize God's promises of our future life in heaven, ignore his provision of armor, gifts, and weapons for spiritual warfare here on earth? I just want to go to heaven. I don't care what happens to me down here. I just want to stop focusing on heaven only. God, if God wanted us just to go to heaven when we got saved, we'd already be there. God wants us to remain here, to be powerful, to represent. You shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. Witnesses of what? Witnesses of his resurrection. Witnesses of his spirit. Witnesses of his truth. God wants his church to represent power and authority in this place. He wants us to go to heaven, and I surely want to go there. But while we're here, he does not want us to be an anemic, lethargic church, acting like a POW, thankful for every little bowl of brine that we get. God wants us to be a powerful church. General Patton, the colorful U.S. commander during World War II, once welcomed a batch of new recruits with these words: "Welcome to Europe and to the war. I am sure some high-ranking windbag back in the States has told you that the secret to winning the war is to die for your country. That is not true. The secret to winning the war is to make the enemy die for his country." I'm just going to be, God, go ahead, I'll just be a rug. Just let the enemy walk on me. I'm just going to, it's teaching me patience. It's teaching me grace. God never intended for us to do that. God wants us to be a soldier. God is saying, I already died for your country. It's time that they die for their country. We need to rise up like soldiers of the cross and say, I will not allow him to take my family. Oh, hallelujah. The same principle holds true to today. It's all right to lose graciously once or twice. But if the gospel is to be taken to the ends of the earth, we better begin to win graciously also. The church is going to win. Some of you that know me know that I don't like to lose. If I lose properly and fairly, I'll accept it. But I don't want somebody to cheat. And the devil's a cheater. I won't listen to him. I won't give him one inch of my life in the description of patience. I'm coming against him with everything I have. Every day I have left to live, I'm coming against him in prayer. We're going to take souls out of the fire because he's already burning them up. I'm telling you, we're going to care about these people. Hopelessness was settling in on Israel. There was only one thing that could prevent their annihilation. They were being beaten and bruised and enslaved, and they weren't supposed to be. What did they finally do? Backed into a corner, Israel discovered the power of prayer. Will we have to wait till we're backed into a corner, till we finally cry out, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me? In Exodus 2:23, it says, "And it came to pass in process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of bondage, and they cried. And their cry came up unto God by reason of the bondage, and God heard their groaning. God remembered his covenant with Abraham and Isaac and with Jacob, and God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them." Prayer turned deception, domination, and destruction into divine deliverance. What do we accept on a daily basis? God, this is just the way it's always going to be. I'm always going to be sick. I'm always going to be tired. I'm never going to receive the promises that you gave me. I'm never going to learn how to pray. I'm always going to be subject to the temptations of the enemy. I'm always going to be subject to the influence of this world. It's just the way it's going to be. Or will we drop to our knees and say, God, I'm going to act as if I'm in a corner today, and I'm going to cry out, because I know if you heard the Israelites, you're going to hear me when I cry. Oh, Jesus, have mercy on me. Teach me to pray. Teach me to rise up and fight for what is right. Pharaoh's power was broken. God's power was released. 2 million slaves, approximately, were set free. Without prayer, Exodus, the book of Exodus, would have been two chapters long. Pharaoh took them over. He beat them. He built cities. And he killed them. Two chapters. But instead, because of prayer, 38 additional chapters were added just to report on God's answer. Do you understand what I just said? Our problem can be two chapters long, and our answer can be 38 chapters long. Our failure can be too long, but our victory can be 38 long. Our failures can only be two chapters long if we choose to pray, but our victory can span 38 chapters of success and victory because we chose to pray. I'm not a slave. I'm a soldier for Jesus Christ. Israel had no army, no economic power, no social status to help them. Israel's only weapon was prayer. That's all they had, was prayer. Well, I wasn't born into, all they had was prayer. Every single one of us can find a place on our knees and lift our hands and pray. And when we pray, mountains begin to move. If you'll start thinking like a soldier instead of a POW, well, I can't make any difference because I messed up yesterday. I can't make any difference because of this or that. God is saying, stop thinking like a POW. You're not in jail. You only think you are. We only think we're a prisoner of war, but really we're powerful. Even the enemy is afraid of you. The enemy knows that if you ever figure out who you are, you're going to take this community. You're going to take this metro area. You're going to take this state and this country for Jesus if you'll get out of jail. I'm finishing up. The early disciples were third-class citizens. People looked at them and said they were unlearned and ignorant men, but their only weapon was prayer. They were not vicious, wild, black ops men. That's not who they were. They were shepherds, somebody. You know, they were just disciples. They were people that believed in Jesus Christ. That one was a tax collector. All they had was prayer. The difference between prayer as we usually conceive it and the kind the early church practice is as different as swimming in a bathtub versus swimming in the ocean. If we realized how powerful prayer was, we feel like when we pray, we're just swimming in a bathtub. I just want to keep it safe. I want to get through the day. But God says you need to swim in an ocean because that's how my power is. My power is endless. My power is deep. It's wide and it's endless. And if you'll figure that out, I'll give you victory. See, what's the secret effect of prayer? The use of spiritual authority entrusted to a believer. If we truly believe that we have spiritual authority, how would we pray? Prayer is something that happens on this side of heaven only. Once we get there, we're not going to pray. We're already there. Lord, bless my food. That which we are to partake of. You just got to look at him and say, thanks, Lord. Man pleads, God gives. Man knocks, God opens. Man is expected to take the initiative. God said, if you ask, you will receive. If you seek, you will find. If you knock, the door will be open. Well, I'm just waiting on God. He's waiting on us. He's saying, if you'll pray, I'll answer. If you'll get in battle, I'll help you win. If you'll take the initiative, I will give it to you. Satan's a sore loser. Even though Jesus won the victory at Calvary, Satan has no intention of vacating the property willingly. He's not just going to say, well, since Calvary happened, I guess I'll just leave. He's like, I got him deceived. They don't think they have miracles, signs, and wonders. They don't think they have authority. But since they don't think, I'll just hang around a while. Give them a little trouble here and there. Keep them busy. But that's why we have the Holy Ghost. the earnest of our inheritance. Ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Power to what? Power to be a witness of his authority. Power to do everything Jesus did and more. Jesus said, greater than these shall you do. He said, if I go, if I ascend, I'm going to send power back and you're going to do greater. You mean like when you cast out thousands of demons? Yeah, you're going to do more. Anybody here cast out 2,000 demons? Not yet. But how about this afternoon? Let's apply ourselves. Let's say, Jesus, you said it and I want to obey you. So give me an opportunity in which I can extend the muscle of your spiritual authority in my life. What can I take dominion over today? Behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Wow. That's powerful. Would you stand with me today? What the first Adam lost through disobedience, the last Adam, Jesus, recovered through obedience. But now the church has to repossess it through prayer. God's power is the engine of prayer. But man's authority is the steering wheel. The engine makes more noise and has more raw power, but the steering wheel determines where the car goes. God gives you the ability. He says, I will give you the power like the engine, but I'm going to let you steer it through prayer. That's what anointing is. The anointing hits. God allows us to steer that power. Will we steer it into selfishness, or will we steer it into selflessness? Eventually, an Allied airplane landed near the POW camp where General Wainwright was imprisoned. An American officer walked up to the fence, saluted, and announced, General, Japan has surrendered. That's all he said. General Wainwright, Japan has surrendered. Armed with that piece of truth, Wainwright limped all the way to the commandant's office. He opened the door and, without even raising his voice, asserted, my commander-in-chief has defeated your commander-in-chief. I am in control now. You must surrender. Without firing a shot, the emaciated, physically handicapped POW took over the camp from the well-fed, heavily armed commandant. How was he able to do it? Because the truth had set him free. He also knew how to use the authority to control power. The Japanese commandant's fear had finally materialized. His captives found out that they were mightier and decided to leave the land of captivity. Like Pharaoh of old, he eventually surrendered. When General Wainwright was flown to Japan in time for the surrender ceremony, he dreaded the moment he would face General MacArthur. In spite of having been liberated, he was still full of shame. He still felt like a failure. He was afraid of facing his commander. As MacArthur walked by, Wainwright could not resist the impulse to hide his face in a corner. But MacArthur spotted him and called out to him. Wainwright obeyed. And as he faced General MacArthur, he completely broke down. A flood of tears overwhelmed him. He stood before his commander in self-inflicted shame. He had failed him. He had surrendered Corregidor. MacArthur reached out to him, embraced him, and simply said, it is okay. You fought well. At the surrender ceremony that followed shortly afterward, every general, admiral and brigadier assigned to the Pacific Theater of Operations was jockeying for position just to stand next to MacArthur. In his classic style, General MacArthur put all of them behind him as he sat at the table with Hirohito's representatives. Only two generals were allowed to stand by him. To his left was British General Percival, who had surrendered Singapore at the beginning of the war. To his right was General Wainwright, who had surrendered Corregidor. As he put his signature on the document that certified Japan's unconditional surrender, MacArthur handed a pen to each one of them. By doing so, he was saying, "You did your best. Don't be too hard on yourselves. We have won." How many of you, under the sound of my voice, feel that every time Jesus enters a room, you hide your face? Because there is a failure in your life. There is an offense. Something happened where you feel that you can't face the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Yet as he walks by, he calls your name. I want to talk to you. If you haven't realized, we have already won. You're on the winning side. Here's a pen. Here's a pen that I used to sign the document of surrender. Jesus is reaching out to every one of us today. Maybe you feel like Wainwright because of a past failure. Maybe you're still living in a POW camp. The enemy has lied to you and has deprived you of everything. Maybe you've lost your command. Maybe you've surrendered. Then you punish yourself, living in hopelessness and despair. Look up to Jesus. He's saying you may have surrendered a flag or two, but the war's been won. On that final day, you're going to stand next to me in victory because we've already won. Jesus, I reject POW. Sense of idealism. We are not POWs, Jesus. We are soldiers in your war. We are successful. We are children of God. We are on the winning side. I'm praying, Lord, that there would be no person in this place that would subject themselves to failure, to the deception that I have failed, I will always be a failure. But there would be those that say, "Lord, didn't do so good yesterday, but I will take my rightful position. I will listen to you, and I will accept the fact that you have washed every failure away, that you have strengthened me, that you have called me your own, that you have placed your name upon me, that you have put your spirit in me, and that you have handed me a pen of victory today. I give you permission to encourage me, Jesus. I give you permission." Jesus is talking to some of you right now. He is speaking to you, and he's speaking to me. Would you come and worship him? Would you just come and worship him and thanking him for victory? I will start thinking like a victor. I will think like I have won, Jesus. We will see miracles, signs, and wonders because of the victory that you have won. You need to look your situation in the face and say, "Your team has surrendered. I am now in charge. I am in charge of this situation." Hallelujah. It's time for us to turn this around, Lord. Hallelujah. Let's worship.
Of heaven touching earth. sound of heaven touching earth, our Father. All of heaven roars your name, sing it louder. And let this place erupt with praise. Can you hear it?
Don't be imprisoned to your disease.
The sound of heaven touching earth.
That's it. Don't be imprisoned to this world.
The sound of heaven touching earth.
I am free.
Our Father.
I am free.
All of heaven roars.
Truth has set me free.
Sing it louder.
I believe it, Jesus.
Let this place
I receive it, Jesus.
Can you hear it?